and what you started out with?
Okay. I started with, I started with as many as I could, really. I was trying to think of what I was interested in having as a multiple, and a lot of the ideas that I had go around something that's a combination of definiteness and indefiniteness, so that the when Colin and I sort of discussed proceeding, I had five different objects to show him, all of which are in different ways approaches to a similar idea, so that I was never at any point seeking to make a particular kind of thing. I was never seeking to make something that was functional, or something, so that I was never designing anything. I was trying to produce a piece of work that I thought could be reproduced multiply. There were various technical procedures involved and various accidental procedures involved. So that the five, there are the first one is made a combination of balloons and curtain rings cased in resin. And what I liked about that one was the relationship of the coarse outside to the smooth inside. The second one was made of to go back to the first one, and I imagined making this as a single plastic object. So I thought this could be, as it were, blow molded. And the second one is a glass, which is the one of the outcomes of some work I'd done with a glass blower. And this is a shape that's blown addition by addition. It's not blown into a mold. It's blown one shape, blown after another shape, blown after the other shape. So it has the kind of zigzag is a kind of controlling feature, but the actual construct is grown rather than finished off. So the relationship between that and the thing we ended up finally with is something to do with that idea that something's grown. I thought this could be made since it's symmetrical around two axes, I thought this could be made in the same way as a bottle is made. And I've been interested in a long time in trying to make a bottle or a glass form using the bottle making technology. The third is is made from stainless steel. It's two stainless steel plates welded together, and spot welded, and then as it were inflated. I mean, actually water's pumped into it, but it puffs out. And so what you get with this is that it's you get a very complex. After polishing, you get this very complex play of light as you move around the object. So within this very definite contour, you have this very fluid, very seemingly fluid object. And I suppose that sort of if growth is growing things was one side, that kind of fluidity is also a part of it. So the final two, the wooden object, which isn't here, which we got a photograph of. Which is a very highly polished, very highly finished piece of wood, and the the found objects, which were these aluminium puddles and drips that I found in the forest, and which we've made into the. Okay, so that sort of wooden, the shape of those wooden, the shapes in the wooden object are quite closely connected to the shapes in the aluminium pieces that we found, which were parts of a burnt out car that I found in the forest. It got so hot the engine had melted, and the and so these are the drips which have been as it were cast onto the forest floor. Some of them are quite complex, and you can see here there's still a bit of the cylinder block in this one here, and the from those we chose a group of five which assembled together to make the so these are the five, those are the five that we chose, and this is their other side. So these what interested me about these is, not unlike what happens in the first object, is that the side which was exposed to the air has this very tight surface and has a degree of polish, whereas the side that was against the forest, you know, so the side that has this very rough kind of crimpled surface. So you have this interesting combination of two different surfaces within one object. And when when the thing is assembled, you also have this kind of rough, smooth, and with the with this one, you have a sort of funny thing where it's seems to be liquid on one side and solid on the other, so that the from on the polished side you have this kind of really kind of quite liquid surface, but on the on this rough side you have a solid surface, and it seems to make the gaps in between it become liquid. So you have that very intriguing the way in which these a complex shape is operating both positively and negatively at the same time, and I suppose that sort of positive negative thing refers back to the way the rough and the smooth on the inside of the first object, or the way in which in the glass and the steel you have a systematic control, which in this case is the edge and the pattern of spot welds, or in the glass is the sequence of shapes one after the other. You have a systematic control, but at the same time, within that, you have something that becomes quite fluid, becomes quite flexible. I showed Colin the objects, and we discussed in each of them. We discussed viability as a kind of technical, on a kind of technical level, whether you could make these. The wooden one is probably the one that is most difficult to think of how you do this without going through a long hand finishing process. We looked at the possibilities of doing this as a stamping rather than as a way that I'd done that, and that seemed to be possible. The bottle is possible, the glasswork is possible, but the molds are incredibly expensive. So, in order to get the unit price down to a reasonable one, you'd have to be going for a much higher production run than we'd be going for. You have to make a pair of steel molds for, or more than a pair. You have to make a tooled steel mold, and that gets very expensive. The same applies to the little resin and wood one there, although that one's the only one where we were thinking about a kind of complete change of material that and so this would be not in wood and resin, but would be just as it were a single plastic object. You know, it's technically feasible, but the production cost gets very high. So casting the casting appeared in the end as the most available technology for the kind of production run and the kind of object we were making. Can I move at all? This is a moving image, is it?
No, you can, of course you can. But if I disappear and just suddenly look, it's not that I'm listening to you. Yeah. I just want to keep a check on this. If the sun really blasts in,
you should be all right. It's midday, so the sun's overhead anyway.
It's quite nice, actually,
because
it just looks like a face and whiteness. It's just enough.
Well, like I say, I mean, it could have been more than five. I could have had a lot more. I was trying to find things that I thought could be made, things that I'd like to make, and technologies I'd like to use, ways of working with materials that I was interested in. So that, I don't really go in for a design process very much, so that I sort of had to start with thinking about materials and how materials what materials I could use, what kind of things I could use. And I also had to sort of work from some ideas about shape, some ideas about the kinds of, I mean, if I was going to make an object, then, you know, what kind of object did I want to make? How do you make a small sculpture? What kind of, so it seems to me it has to be materially specific. You have to kind of think about material, form, context, and all those kinds of things. So I started off very loosely with following various approaches to material, approaches to form making, or whatever.
None of these objects are functional.
Yeah, I mean, there were the
we're just about to.
You asked me whether any of them were functional and why not.
I'll ask again. None of these are functional. Was that a decision that you made?
There's two ways to answer. One would be to ask you whether function necessarily applies. You have to pick it up and use it for something. In that case, no, none of them are functional. On the other hand, you could say that ornament has a function, and that people have ornaments or objects to look at because they play a role in their lives, and in that sense, they are functional objects. But taking the narrower definition that this is something for someone to use to do something with, then no, none of them were functional. What I wanted to make was something that was much closer to an ornament or an objet d'art, to try and work out if it was, because actually that's what I do. You know, that's when Jessica's home base asked me to do it. It doesn't mean I suddenly have to start making functional objects. You know, I make prints. I've made multiple things before, so there's no reason why, because the production run goes up, why I should abandon that as a procedure. Yes, there are interesting things about making an object which can be used, but I think it was more interesting to try and make an ornament or an art object which had tried to engage somehow with ideas about meaning.
In what sense did you feel these were right for objects, ornaments, things that would go into?
Okay, so it's to do with scale on the first. I think the steel one is bordering on the big. It's actually quite surprising when you come to look at it how small, unless you're making a fridge, how small things are for people in most people's homes. So they have ornaments on a shelf or whatever. So the size was a fairly significant factor. With what we've ended up making, the wooden one and the steel one as well, all are similarly free of gravity, so that they can exist either as a flat object on a flat surface, or else they can be wall-mounted. It was also that, in the same way as a plate can be on the table or on the wall. It was also that, I think that was probably a fairly critical point in favor when we came to consider making it. Actually, people put things on the wall easier than they put things down, so that the ability for the object to be on the wall, and with the cast, it actually can be on the wall in a number of different permutations.
Were you thinking about the particular family that you were paired with? Did they influence?
I was looking at their ornaments. I was interested in their ornaments, yeah. And there was one or two spaces in their house that I was interested in. And I thought about, I thought about something to float in their pond. And that's still around as an idea. There's in their dining room, in their room upstairs, there's a shelf with some small Indian ornaments on it that I found quite interesting. Both the scale and the kinds of things they were, because they're quite... They have a number of paintings which are, they have some quite serious paintings there. I wanted to try and make, so yes, I thought about them in the, I wanted to try and make something which I thought, they could have in their house without it being a problem.
What do you think they'll think of this?
Well, I don't know. I hope they like it. I hope they find it intriguing. There is always the problem of how you deal with the question of what it is, because it isn't if it's a non-referential object, the answer to the question becomes much more complex or seemingly maybe evasive. So the answer to what it is that it's something to provoke reflection, and it has and the its two-sidedness, its double aspect. Is a part of that, as well as the kind of the complexity of its shape and the ability of the shape to be read in kind of multiple multiple different ways. So in a way, the answer to what it is that it's a kind of aid to aid to reverie.
Are you familiar with home base?
Yeah. I've bought art materials in home base. I've used home base as a source of, it was the starting point for a piece of work that I made with another artist. We went around home base looking for connectors. I think the profile of your average home base user might not exist. I mean, I think home base might be as intentionally as diverse as the population, so that the there are going to be people who won't look at it, but equally there are going to be people who will look at it.
You weren't making any concessions to popular taste. You weren't.
What does home base? I don't know if home base makes concessions to popular taste. I think that would be presumptive of me and arrogant to assume that I knew what popular taste was. One thing that's clear from, actually not least from the work that Colin's done, is that you can underestimate people's taste. Yeah, I know.
Because you felt were quite similar to your sculpture. What's the difference?
I think the drips exist probably in all foundries. The difference, there isn't a great deal of difference. The difference would be between the top and bottom sides. The bottom surface of these aluminium pieces is not formed against a hard surface. It's formed against leaf mold. It's burnt its way through leaf mold. It's formed against the soft surface. So it has this rather complex surface underneath, whereas the top has this hard dripped over. And it's important that the cast they make has this double character. So that on the one hand, it's kind of the drip is accidental, but a cast is intentional. And when the metal is poured into the mold, the metal forms against this, the intentional surface of the mold, and the top surface in the cast has a similar quality as the top surface of the drips. Against the floor, what you get is a basically an impression of the floor. The floor becomes the mold. I've gotten this impression of the wooden of the floor of the wood, the leaves. To grass, etc. And so it's an impression of something, as well as a material accident.
So if the drips on the floor in the foundry wouldn't have appealed to you, wouldn't have intrigued you.
Well, they would have. They might well have done. I thought, I mean, I also liked, I thought what I found was quite violent, was quite aggressive. Someone burning out a car in a wood, it was quite an aggressive act, and quite shocking. I don't think that's particularly present in the, and it's quite unexpected, you know, it's kind of, whereas in the foundry you might expect to find drips and residue. So this had a kind of, in picking it up, I think it had a charge to it that maybe it wouldn't, maybe I wouldn't have had it. So it was, I mean, the intriguing thing was that to come across this, you know, the kind of an inferno in the forest, which was the foundry is a contained inferno. You know, it's what you expect in the foundry. Some drips and smashes.
So the difference is an actual difference in the quality of the metal.
It's a difference in the quality of the metal. It's also a difference in my attention, I think. Well, the fact that the ones in the woods, you know, you come across them as a sort of as a surprise or as a shock, whereas in the in the factory they're more, it seems that it's more part of the process. In terms of whether the form is different, I think there is I think that the surface the metal was running onto, a soft surface, probably led to a different formation of, but that I can't be sure. Certainly, the fact that the metal was running over a organic material leads to a different quality of surface underneath.
How did you come across them? Perhaps you could just tell us how you discovered them. You mentioned along the way that you felt charged.
Well, it was I was out for a walk. And I came across a car that somebody had burnt out in the woods, and kind of crashed the car into the woods and burnt it out. So it's the aftermath of quite a kind of aggressive piece of. It wasn't an accident; it was an intentional burning. It's the aftermath of quite an intentional piece of vandalism. At the same time, all around this sort of black area were these silver drips kind of lying on the forest and gleaming on the forest floor. So quite naturally, I kind of picked them up, you know, because they seemed kind of extraordinary.
Does the violence that created those pieces of metal, do you the whole is quite a kind of settled and comforting and homely place?
Is it? If you want to read that, I mean, I think home is equally. Home is. Home can be both a prison and a comfort. If you wanted to read that as the duality in the world.
They
don't have much connection. They've got quite a lot of contemporary music, though, most times, and CD covers or cassette covers would have a fair amount of contemporary graphics, contemporary approaches within it. They've probably got a state-of-the-art sound system. TV.
No
sculpture. Very few. And some interesting clothes. They've got young children. Some teenagers have got some quite interesting sneakers knocking around. So, I mean, they're not. People aren't as rigid in their appreciation of things.
But why don't they have sculpture and paintings and works that are called contemporary art?
A lot of the time, it may well be because there isn't anything available at a price that they can afford. Yeah, you're right. I can't speak in general about it. I think the artist owes it to themselves to make things which they can stand by, which mean something to them, mean the artist. I think the artist owes it to themselves to make something which they can support, and which enables them to articulate whatever concern they have. The work is successful to the extent to which that those concerns are communicated. But it's artists that make the art. It's not their obligations to anyone that makes art. Yes, of course, it interests me. In the same way as the way in which people have used television as a means of acquiring an interest in informing their interest in contemporary art. So you only have to look at the way the Turner Prize has worked to know what relation it is to the things that people see on television, to the way in which they go out and look at other things, the books that they then buy or the postcards they then buy in support of that, or to know that, to think that it's part of an interesting process. And yes, I'm always delighted when people want things. I mean, if people want the things that you make, on a kind of very simple level, it's very satisfying.
Do you think you'd go to Homebase and watch?
Well, and buy the lot.
just one more question. What, first of all, attracted you to the project?
I'd seen Colin's National Gallery project with the Constable Hayway, and I like that. So that when Colin wrote to me, I was intrigued by what he was asking about.
Was it the cornfield?
No, it was the cornfield.
Yeah.
I'd seen Colin's cornfield, the Constable of the Cornfield, at the reproductions and the way in which his research into the way in which people use pictures at the National Gallery, and I like that, and I've been interested in what he was saying about how people have pictures in their lives. So I, when he wrote to me, I was interested to follow it up. Well, it's to do what I said. I thought he looked at the way people had things in their lives in a non-judgmental way, and I thought that was interesting. He didn't assume that he knew what was good taste, what was bad taste. He just realized that people had things because they mattered to them.